Structural barrier shielding. Any structural barrier, including walls, floors, the ceiling, and windows, can protect you from radiation and are generally divided into primary and secondary barrier categories. A primary barrier is defined as one which the primary beam strikes in the course of routine practice. A secondary barrier is normally only struck by secondary or scattered radiation coming from the patient. Regulations for practice forbid ever pointing the X-ray beam toward the control booth, so it's always considered a secondary barrier, protecting the operator from scatter. Some basic minimum requirements exist between primary and secondary barriers according to regulations as well. It's important to remember that pure lead may not always be utilized. However, whatever the material used, we still describe its protective ability in units of lead equivalency. Primary barriers must contain shielding effectiveness equivalent to 1.5 millimeters of pure lead. They also must be a minimum of 6.8 feet or 80 inches in height. Secondary barriers must contain shielding effectiveness equivalent to 0.8 millimeters of pure lead and must be a minimum of 7 feet in height. In practice, any scatter reaching the operator behind a secondary barrier or the control booth must be scattered at least twice due to these safety regulations, and therefore would be extremely low energy by that point. Let's talk about the different types of radiation areas. A controlled area is an area occupied primarily by radiation workers. The occupancy must be known, the working conditions must be supervised, and the radiation equipment must be inspected regularly. Barriers must be sufficient to keep the occupational exposure rates below 100 microgray per week. An example would be behind the control panel within the X-ray room. Uncontrolled area is a portion of the imaging department which non-radiation workers, such as receptionists and managers, waiting patients, or the general public, can be expected to regularly occupy. Structural barriers here must contain shielding sufficient to keep exposure rates below 20 microgray per week. Examples include the hallways outside of the X-ray rooms or areas immediately adjacent to the exam rooms. Posted warnings. All radiation warning signs should have the familiar cloverleaf radiation pattern printed against a yellow background. The cloverleaf itself can be red, maroon, or black. A radiation area should have a warning sign displayed if a particular room may ever exceed 1 milligray in 5 days or 50 microgray in any 1 hour. Regarding the use of fluoroscopy, these signs should be observed if the room can produce 0.05 millisieverts in any 1 hour at 30 centimeter distance from the fluoroscope. A standard sign reading "Caution, radiation area" must be posted near all the entryways to the room. High radiation areas. If it is feasible that the accumulated exposure might ever exceed 1 milligray in any 1 hour or 5 sieverts in any 1 hour at 1 meter from the fluoroscope, the sign posted must read "Caution, high radiation area." This would typically include hot labs and nuclear medicine departments and tags for radioactive patients or corpses.